Before it meets the bottle, it's born with water and grain, then lives in a barrel. The distilling of alcoholic spirits is big business and a near sacred religion. Bourbon, scotch, rum, gin, vodka, or tequila. What's your pleasure? Now, distilleries on Modern Marvels. They eye the color, swirl the glass, inhale the bouquet, sip, and then ponder their actions.
This is absolutely exquisite.
These are not wine snobs. They're whiskey snobs. At the annual Whiskies of the World Expo in San Francisco, the $100 admission offers a chance to experience the finest that distilleries have to offer.
Smell the difference. I mean, it's just a
great mixer. It's great on the rocks.
Bourbon has a flavor profile that peaks at a certain age.
This is perfect for early in the day.
It all goes back to one thing, and that is the growing sophistication of American palates. Consumers are looking for greater challenge, and they often believe that a product that costs $25 or $30 is going to give them that challenge.
The emergence of premium and super premium bottles is a potent sales trend in an already huge industry. In the United States alone, the sale of legal alcoholic spirits tops more than $45 billion per year. For many distilleries, the challenge is to marry centuries of traditional distilling methods with the need for high-tech, high-volume production. What was once one man and one still is now a computer-controlled symphony of water, vapor, and spirit. Today's massive commercial pot stills have revolutionized an ancient technology, but the science of distillation has never changed. Alcohol is produced when yeast is added to a mixture, or mash, of water and a fermentable organic ingredient like grain. The yeast converts the grain sugars into ethyl alcohol molecules. When the mixture is heated, the alcohol vaporizes and rises into the neck of the still. As it enters the coils, it is cooled and condensed into liquid form. The result is a colorless, odorless, neutral grain spirit.
A spirit means originally in the Middle Ages, when it was applied to distillation, it meant that they were extracting the soul from the body of the liquid. They're purifying it and getting rid of the body.
Distilled spirits really have been around now, we're believing, since around 3000 BC. Recent archaeological finds of terracotta stills have been found in Pakistan. But also, the Chinese were very, very likely distilling as early as 1000 BC, distilling rice wine into spirits.
In 12th century Italy, monks began producing spirits from wine. As the technology spread throughout Europe, spirits were distilled from grain crops such as barley or wheat. People soon learned that substituting alcoholic spirits for drinking water was a practical way to stay alive.
One thing distilled spirits did do is replaced water drinking. All kinds of horrible diseases would be passed on by unsanitary water sources, and pouring spirits into the water would kill off some of that. Drinking it in place of the water would certainly be an improvement up to a point.
In the American colonies, the practice was also considered crucial to good health. Initially, colonists distilled spirits from pears, peaches, and cherries. Eventually, many began to favor an apple brandy called Applejack. But one spirit dominated the colonial palate. Rum, made from sugarcane, was America's first drink of choice.
Columbus brought sugarcane to the Western Hemisphere on his second voyage in 1494 and planted it on the island of Hispaniola, which is now today Haiti, Dominican Republic.
Typically, rum was imported from the Caribbean. American colonists also purchased a sugarcane byproduct, molasses, which allowed them to make their own rum. By the 1660s, New London, Connecticut was the rum distilling capital of the New World. But the Caribbean was, and still is, the worldwide home of rum distilling.
Bacardi right now is the world market leader in rum. They make and sell more rum than anybody. They started in the 19th century in Cuba as a small distillery. The owner, Don Facundo Bacardi, came from Spain, and he was interested in technology and in trying out some of the latest innovations.
Because yeast converts sugar to alcohol, sugarcane's byproduct, molasses, is an ideal spirit base. After the juice is extracted and boiled three times, the molasses is fermented and distilled into rum. Bacardi set out to tame the fiery, dark Caribbean rumbustions. What he helped perfect was a smoother, lighter rum that was highly mixable. It was called white rum.
The mojito, like all things Latin, is sweeping the country. This is such a wonderful and simple drink. I have some leaves of mint in the bottom of my glass, and I'm going to put a little bit of simple syrup. You could use plain sugar, granulated sugar. And I want to bruise the mint leaves to open a couple of veins and let some flavor out into my drink. Now I'm going to add a sour ingredient, because I have a sweet ingredient, and that's going to be fresh lime juice and some good superior white rum from Puerto Rico as the base. Now we do ice. And we're going to top it with soda and a great, big, beautiful sprig of mint on top. The mojito.
The popularity of rum, the first drink of colonial America, didn't last.
Once the American colonies and the British decided to stop seeing eye to eye about things, the British turned off the taps on the molasses supply, and that forced the colonists to look around for other alternatives.
Whiskey, distilled from grains, became the patriotic drink of a newborn United States of America. Irish and Scottish colonists had been privately distilling whiskey from Indian corn, barley, and rye for decades. But now, the demand was huge.
Distilling in the colonies was an absolutely necessary part of being a farmer. Because America was so fertile and grain of all types grew so well here, they needed to do something with the excess of grain.
And they found early on that if you distill it, it won't rot. The volume is much reduced. It's easy to transport, at least easier than carrying huge bushels of grain. And there's a ready market for it and profit to be made. So a very common piece of farm equipment on the frontier was a copper pot still.
Even George Washington promoted the practice of private distillation.
George Washington was big on encouraging the colonists to do things for themselves using the latest techniques. So he had a modern whiskey distillery built on Mount Vernon.
Archaeological findings at Mount Vernon revealed that Washington was producing a rye whiskey, the spirit favored by early American whiskey distillers. More than 200 years later, a new movement called micro-distilling is following in the footsteps of Washington. Anchor Brewing in San Francisco is known for leading the surge in beer microbrewing. But now, its tiny distillery is making colonial-style whiskey in small-sized batches. The result is Old Potrero straight rye whiskey.
This is a mash of malted rye that has been crushed in a mill and mixed with warm water and cooked, and the temperature goes up and up, and then gradually the enzymes convert the starch to sugar. In the American whiskey tradition, we ferment the mash. This is a bubbling mash. And then when the fermentation finishes, we distill the mash. We put the whole thing in the still.
At Anchor, two copper pot stills complete the distillation. A wash still converts the mash to a liquid, low-strength alcohol. And a spirit still refines and condenses the spirit into high-strength alcohol.
And then what comes out, which interests a lot of people and surprises people, is just a clear liquid. It's the same whether you're making gin or rum or whiskey. There's no color.
Much like colonial distillers, Anchor Distilling ages its whiskey in oak barrels to add color and flavor. But it was another American spirit that took the art of barrel aging to fire-charred immortality. distilling spirits wasn't always a profitable, high-volume business. On October 28, 1919, the U.S. Congress approved legislation that sobered up the nation. The Volstead Act enforced an immediate ban on the manufacture, sale, or transportation of intoxicating liquors. Prohibition was a major victory for a group of Americans convinced that alcohol was a scourge of mankind.
The temperance movement started soon after the War of Independence, when some people noticed that their fellow Americans were spending way too much time bellied up to the bar and not enough time building a country. And this was always a problem in early America. Liquor was used day in, day out.
But as the temperance movement celebrated, the large brewing and distilling companies faced utter devastation. Another type of distiller moved in to fill the void.
Moonshining was always popular in America just to escape the taxes. But once Prohibition came in, the moonshiners found themselves very popular indeed, and their skills spread to every part of America.
Ultimately, Prohibition was a failure that cost the federal government an estimated $500 million a year in lost excise taxes. It also nearly wiped out an American institution called bourbon whiskey.
The Manhattan, next to the martini, one of the most classic of American cocktails. I begin with my flavor, a dash of Angostura bitters. Some good Italian sweet vermouth. I like my Manhattans one part vermouth and two parts bourbon. The Manhattan can be made with American rye whiskey as well. And it's a stirred drink. And the traditional garnish for the Manhattan is the maraschino cherry. The Manhattan.
The story of American bourbon began with the Whiskey Rebellion. In 1792, the federal government decided to levy a tax against all distilled spirits. And farmer distillers rebelled. The uprising was crushed. But many packed up and moved to the frontier, away from governmental control, into present-day Kentucky. It was here in Bourbon County that bourbon whiskey was born. What the whiskey makers found was a land perfect for growing corn, the primary grain in bourbon. The other crucial ingredient is as important today as it was 200 years ago.
In the whole United States, there's only one area that's got perfect bourbon-making water, and that's the Bluegrass region in Kentucky, and it tails down a little bit into central Tennessee. But the thing that makes that water perfect is that it's limestone-rich, so it's really hard water, but no iron. Because iron ruins the whiskey.
Prohibition destroyed dozens of bourbon distillers. But the Jim Beam Distillery in Claremont, Kentucky was resurrected. And today carries on a six-generation tradition.
A lot of people think Jim Beam started the company, but it was actually his great-grandfather, Jacob Beam, who back in 1795 started making whiskey for about 30 miles from here, a little place called Hardin Creek.
The modern Beam Distillery has the capacity to produce more than 10 million gallons of whiskey in a single year. The massive operation requires constant quality checks, beginning with the grain shipments. Each batch is checked for odor quality, excessive cracking of the kernels, and moisture percentage before it is crushed into a powdery grist. Jim Beam bourbons also contain rye and barley. At the Maker's Mark Distillery in Loretto, Kentucky, winter wheat is preferred to rye to give the whiskey its own smooth taste. However, both bourbons agree on one crucial step, the sour mash process. A small portion of the sour leftover mash from a previous batch is taken from the still and added to the new incoming mash.
What that does is it lends some continuity to the whiskey from batch to batch because you're using some of the flavor components from earlier distillations. It also helps us control the pH of the mash, which is a critical thing.
While Kentucky is the home to bourbon, Its neighbor to the south enjoys a unique worldwide fame. At the Jack Daniel's Distillery in Lynchburg, Tennessee, the whiskey looks like bourbon, but its distinctive flavor has a hint of sweet charcoal.
Tennessee whiskey is a lot like bourbon, except it's got one extra step, where once it comes out of the still, they pour it in a tub that's full of charcoal and let it filter through all the way to the bottom. It takes a long time, but it makes for a smoother whiskey. That's the theory.
The sugar maple charcoal mellowing is the dividing line between Tennessee whiskey and bourbon. But both styles ultimately end up in the same place, a charred American white oak barrel. The process begins when the 52-gallon oak barrels are purchased from a cooperage. These barrel makers assemble the staves and fire char the inside, where the charred wood makes contact with the whiskey.
You can see the char here. This is called an alligator char. The pattern sort of tends to resemble alligator skin. When we put the bourbon up in this barrel, the changes of temperature through the day will actually force the whiskey in and out of the walls of the barrel through that char.
It is essentially a living, breathing thing. The barrel allows it contact with air. And the barrel, because it's porous, in the warmth of the summer expands and breathes out. And then when the weather turns cold, the barrel contracts and breathes in.
There are some 160 different wood chemicals that get dissolved. There are six that taste and smell like vanilla. There's a number of wood sugars. There's caramel. There's tannins and smoke and all that get dissolved when it gets hot.
Because the sun and the wind are so critical to good aging, distilleries are particular about the location and architecture of the barrel house. At Jim Beam, some contain over 20,000 whiskey barrels and reach a height of 9 stories.
The aging characteristics high in the house are very much different than they are down here on the first floor. Up there, temperatures are higher, conditions are more extreme, and the whiskey will actually pick up color and flavor quicker and high in the house than they do down here.
After aging a minimum of 2 years, the individual whiskey barrels have different color and taste characteristics. Most distilleries then commingle the barrels to obtain a consistent product for bottling. But at Maker's Mark, a process called barrel rotation is practiced to avoid having any two barrels age differently.
After they've been up in the top of the warehouse for 3 summers, the tasting panel votes on it. And if it's achieved enough maturity, the ensuing fall will move those barrels to a lower spot in the warehouse to complete their aging. And we think that that gives us a much more uniform product.
These barrels are also commingled and then filtered before bottling. While bourbon remains the true spirit of America, it's not the world's top-selling whiskey. Across the sea, Scottish distillers use fire and smoke to produce a whiskey so good, they say angels demand their own share. In Kentucky bourbon country, a charred American white oak barrel loses its usefulness after aging just one batch of whiskey. But instead of being discarded, the barrels are disassembled and sold. In Scotland, Scotch whiskey distillers eagerly purchase the used bourbon barrels.
The casks that they use are made out of that beautiful American white oak. It's still got enough wood sugars in the white oak to give Scotch both color and lovely, gentle honey, vanilla-like flavors.
Beyond the barrel, the similarities between American bourbon whiskey and Scotch whiskey come to an end. While corn is the primary grain in bourbon, Scotch distillers use only 100% barley.
Everyone in Scotland would probably deny it, but it's believed that distilling came to Scotland from the Irish. And it's believed the monks would have brought across the secrets of distilling to Scotland.
Legally, Scotch is produced only in Scotland. If the Scotch is made from pure malted barley at a single distillery, it's known as single malt Scotch.
I have a smoky peaty one here because they come in all different styles. And this one is heavy, smoky, and peaty the way the Scots like it. And I would suggest that you drink it neat. But a good master distiller will tell you that if you put a few drops of water, that water will open up the aromas and the secrets that are locked inside of your scotch.
On Islay, a remote island on Scotland's west coast, the whiskies have the smokiest flavor in all of Scotland. For nearly two centuries, Islay's Laphroaig Distillery has achieved its trademark smokiness through a tradition known as barley floor malting.
Well, there are three raw materials made in making whiskey, and barley is the first one of them. We need barley, we need water, and we need yeast. Without barley, we would have no material that we could use to extract the sugar that we're then going to ferment.
Malting is the process of forcing barley to germinate. Laphroaig is one of a handful of single malt distillers that performs floor malting on premise. When the barley arrives, it's first steeped in water to a moisture content of 45%. Approximately 6 tons of the grain is then spread onto the malting floor to begin drying.
We're actually trying to trick the barley grain into thinking it's spring and it's time to germinate and grow into a new barley plant. It's developing enzymes, and these enzymes we can use later on in the process. They will break down all the starch, which is the food store of the grain.
After germination, the barley is introduced to its famous companion, peat. Peat is a fuel source formed by decaying plant matter. It remains the primary flavor catalyst in single malt scotch.
So when you dig it and dry it out, you've got something that's almost like stone that burns with a lovely fragrance and with some heat.
The barley is spread evenly on the floor of a kiln. The peat fire smokes the barley for flavor, and in the process, stops the germination.
All that smoke will be drawn slowly up through the bed of grain, but as the smoke is actually rising through the bed of grain, the grain is absorbing that smoky character, and that ultimately makes the character of Laphroaig.
When the malted barley is finally smoked and dried, it's ground and introduced to Scotch whisky's other crucial ingredient.
The water is so important, it almost defines the flavor that is possible to create in a distillery. It's not the only factor, but if you don't have the right quality of water, no matter what size of still or what apparatus you set up here, you won't get a good whisky.
The local water is the reason many distilleries in Scotland have been at the same location for generations. By combining the perfect water source with the perfect pot still, a unique whisky emerges.
Every distillery has their own particular design of still. Ours here, they're very small in comparison to some you'll see, very squat.
In the Scottish Highlands region on the famous River Spey, the Tormore Distillery uses a different strategy, very large stills.
In practice, we know after 200 or 300 years of trial and error, if we put small stills on certain locations, we get wonderful whiskies. But in other locations, it's the big stills that work best.
To further refine the spirit, a unique purifier is positioned at the top of the Tormore stills.
It actually helps to stop any of the rougher spirit elements from going through to the condenser. It's like a filter in a way. It's actually very good, but it adds body and character to the spirit that we have here at Tormore.
Deeper into the Speyside farmlands, Glendronach is the only distillery in Scotland that clings to an ancient still technology. While others heat the stills by piping in hot steam, Glendronach practices direct firing with coal.
It produces particular compounds within the whisky as it's being distilled that aren't produced when the heat is generated within the still from a steam coil or some other means.
While the shape of the still and the heat source have influence, barrel aging is what defines the flavor of single malt scotch. And in Scotland, it's a long wait. Single malts are routinely aged for 12, 15, and sometimes even 30 and 40 years. As the barrels age, they absorb the character of the air and the land around them. In exchange, the whiskey barrel gives something back. It's called the angel share.
In the cask, we are losing 2% of the alcohol per year. 2% of the volume disappears. So what is happening as the whiskey evaporates is the volume inside the cask goes down and the angels get their reward.
The worldwide sales of single malt are exploding, but it remains only a fraction of the world's supply of Scotch whiskey. Most Scotch is blended, representing over 90% of all Scotch whiskey.
In blended Scotch whiskies, many single malts are put into a whiskey vatting along with grain whiskies, and that's blended whiskey.
Grain whiskies made from corn or unmalted barley are used to soften the single malt scotches, making most blended scotches less expensive and more appealing to a mass market. Whether blended or single malt, Scotch is the second largest export in Scotland and a source of intense national pride. On the other side of the world, there is a wild spirit distilled from a wicked-looking plant that inspires its own passionate following. In the heart of San Francisco, Tommy's Mexican restaurant is regularly packed with a devoted crowd. They come to experience the best the tequila distilleries have to offer. At Tommy's, all of the tequilas are distilled entirely from agave, a relative of the cactus.
At Tommy's, we've taken a conscious stand to only serve arguably the best tequila, which is 100% agave tequila.
The margarita made with the spirit of Mexico, 100% blue agave tequila and fresh lime juice. 3/4 of a part of the sour ingredient, fresh lime juice. 1 part of the sweet ingredient, orange liqueur. And 100% blue agave tequila. And let's shake it up. It is truly one of the most popular cocktails in the world today. The margarita. What a beautiful drink.
Tequila distilleries are centered in only one region of the world, the warm mountainous area of Jalisco, Mexico, where the blue agave grows. While there are over 400 species of agave, by law, only the juice of the blue agave can be used for distilling tequila. Its seductive flavor has been known for hundreds of years. The Aztec Indians fermented the agave pulp into a beverage called pulque. The plant was considered sacred, and pulque was used in religious ceremonies.
With the arrival of the Spaniards in Mexico in the 16th century, they brought distillation techniques and applied those to that product that the natives were using, and that's how tequila came out.
Today, nearly 250,000 acres of blue agave are waiting to become tequila in Mexico's nearly 100 distilleries. The plant takes as long as 12 years to reach maturity before it can be harvested. The dangerous art of the jimador, or the agave harvester, is a crucial skill in tequila production. Using an implement called the coa, the workers shave the razor-sharp leaves close to the stem, called a piña.
This is a piña of agave. As you can see here, we have the heart of the agave, which is really the stem. Here is the leaves of the agave. It's very important the quantity of leaves you leave into the stem or into the piña.
These 45 to 220 pound monsters are then collected and moved to the distillery. At the Herradura distillery, processing the piñas remains a traditional practice. The halved piñas are hand-loaded into large masonry ovens called hornos. They are cooked for 24 hours to soften the hard hearts of the agave and turn their starches into sugars. At the nearby Sauza distillery, the larger scale production has embraced modern technology. Here, the piñas are shredded, then heated in a massive open cooker with superheated steam to extract the juice. Shredding the piñas allows more even cooking. Ultimately, 20% more agave juice is extracted than with the traditional oven method. Finally, an autoclave, or giant pressure cooker, converts the starches to sugars.
So by applying modern techniques, we have been able to keep the flavor of tequila and the characteristics that the consumer looks for in tequila, and also improve productivity, quality, and even working conditions.
Tequila is sold in two forms, 100% agave or mixto. The mixto contains at least 51% pure agave juice and a mixture of sugarcane or other sugars. The overwhelming majority of the less expensive mixto tequila is exported to the United States, where it fuels the margarita craze. But as palates become more sophisticated, America is catching on to the 100% pure agave tequilas. Growing agave is an expensive long-term risk. And when demand for tequila jumped in the 1990s, agave growers couldn't deliver.
There was a huge acute agave shortage back in the year 2000 when price increased by 15-fold. So agave was so short that all producers wanted to extract as much tequila from agave as possible. So that prompted a major modernization of the tequila industry.
In order to further maximize sugar yields, researchers turned their attention to plant propagation in an attempt to clone the perfect agave.
So we are doing DNA analysis of an agave to make sure that it is blue agave. And from one cell, you can go all the way to 1,500 plants that are identical and disease-free. The main advantage is that they are, first of all, genetically perfect. There is no genetic modification at all, but we know that they are blue agave. They are disease-free, and they will grow at the same rate.
More than 250,000 cloned agaves are raised in Sauza's massive greenhouse facility. After 1 year under controlled conditions, they are replanted in the open fields. These perfect blue agaves will mature with larger leaves that will yield more sugar and ultimately produce more tequila. As growers and researchers learn to better control the mysterious blue agave, it could mean the end of an ancient art. The jimadores may one day become obsolete. The planting of lab-propagated, uniformly sized agave is paving the way for mechanized harvesting. Tequila makers struggle to maintain tradition, even as they employ modern technology. But another clear spirit revels in high technology. In fact, its makers are in a race to distill a spirit so light and pure it might be hangover-free. When most spirits are distilled, they come out clear and colorless. For whiskey and other spirits, it's off to the barrel house for years of aging and coloring. But some clear spirits skip the barrel and go right to the bottle, including gin.
The classic martini is the king of cocktails, and I'm talking about the one with a dash of vermouth, and that dash of vermouth varies from person to person a lot, and a good London dry gin. Take your spoon. I don't shake, I stir. Sorry, James Bond, but to me, when you have only spirits, you should stir. And then we're going to strain it in. The garnish. Originally in the 19th century, it was a lemon peel. Now it's become an olive. I like both. So I'm going to put an olive and a little bit of the oil of a lemon on top of the drink and drop it in. This is a true classic. The king of cocktails, the martini.
The juniper berry is the predominant flavor in most gins. In the 14th century, it was widely believed that juniper-based elixirs could combat the deadly bubonic plague. In the 17th century, English soldiers encountered the juniper-based spirit in Holland.
And they were given quantities of gin to drink before going into battle. It's what we now know as Dutch courage. But when they came back to England after the wars, they brought the recipes for gin with them.
During the gin craze of the early 18th century, it became the crack cocaine of the English underclass. In 1733, London distillers produced 11 million gallons, 14 gallons for every man, woman, and child. Eventually, the government regulated gin and curbed consumption. In the 21st century, gin has evolved into a refined, multi-flavored spirit.
With gin, we take pure, neutral spirits and we add botanicals or herbs, fruit, all sorts of mysterious, exotic things.
At the Beefeater Gin Distillery in London, a tradition that James Burrough began in 1863 is upheld with 21st century technology. The process begins with a grain spirit made from corn, wheat, and barley. But it's the secretive botanical recipe that makes it gin.
So these are the botanicals that are used in Beefeater Gin. These are juniper berries, the most important flavor in gin, angelica root, coriander seed, bitter orange peel, lemon peel, both from Spain, angelica seed, which gives some of that spiciness to the gin, ground almond, orris root, that one that holds in the flavors, and the last one here is licorice.
After selecting and quality testing all of the botanical ingredients, the crucial step occurs in the copper pot still.
A Beefeater here, we do one extra process, which is very important to us. When we combine the botanicals and the spirit in our stills, we leave them there to steep, to soak, to marinate, if you like, for 24 hours before we distill. What that does is to get much more complexity from those botanicals.
As the distilled gin emerges, a highly trained nose is the final quality control instrument.
I can really see, or rather smell, what's happening. When we're running the stills, all those botanicals release their flavors at different stages. First thing in the morning, we get very strong citrus notes coming across. A little later, now we've got certainly citrus coming through, but juniper is beginning to come through. And during the day, all those botanicals will come through one after another.
Gin distilling has a long and rich tradition. But in the United States, its sales are only 25% of its clear, yet flavorless cousin, vodka.
The Cosmopolitan is a modern classic with four simple ingredients. Fresh lime juice, I emphasize fresh. That's our sour ingredient. We need a sweet ingredient. We're going to put a little orange liqueur, about a quarter of an ounce. I'm going to do 2 ounces of premium citrus vodka, and then a little bit of cranberry juice. Not so much that it turns the drink red. Now we shake hard. I shake drinks that have fruit juices, and I stir drinks that are all spirits. The harder you shake it, the better the drink will taste. We're trying to wake the drink up, not put it to sleep. Here we go. This beautiful thing is garnished with a little bit of orange zest, and the oil in the zest is what I want, and I'm gonna do something very special to get that oil out. I'm gonna flame it with a match and drop it in. The Cosmopolitan, a modern classic.
Vodka is associated closely with a region of origin. Russia and Poland are both credited with distilling vodka from grain as early as the 15th century. It was this flavorless, pure spirit that ultimately conquered America. Vodka took off in the 1950s and 60s when James Bond and a more affluent cocktail-loving crowd fell in love with the mixable spirit. The party is still going strong. In 2003, over 40 million cases of vodka were sold in the United States, making it by far the most popular drink at the bar.
With vodka, the name of the game is to remove impurities. So you end up with a very clean alcohol, and that the bad alcohols, the impurities, are eliminated as far as possible.
In this spirit world, the impurities haunting the vodka are methanol and other undesirable compounds that are referred to as congeners. While they occur naturally during distillation, congeners are suspected to contribute to the alcoholic hangover. High-tech vodka distilling is now targeting congeners and delivering super premium vodkas so pure that many consumers are hoping the hangover is a thing of the past.
Unfortunately, one of the compounds that gives you a hangover is alcohol. So if you drink enough super premium vodka, you will still get a hangover.
At Belvedere Vodka in Żerodów, Poland, removing congeners involves a combination of extremely pure water and multiple distillations. Distilling takes place in a continuous three-column still. While a pot still makes just one batch at a time, the continuous still provides a constant flow.
The raw spirit is diluted with water, then heated and sent to the pre-distillation column. Here, the condensed impurities, which boil at a temperature lower than the boiling point of ethyl alcohol, are being separated and removed.
The spirit then enters the rectification column. Here, rising steam heats a series of 64 perforated plates. As the liquid spirit vaporizes, the plates help trap and remove the impurities and water. The vapor is condensed back to liquid, and the process is repeated over and over until virtually all impurities are removed. What exits is a high-strength spirit. A fourth redistillation finishes the process, producing a pure super premium spirit. At the Sky Vodka Distillery in Pekin, Illinois, the massive column stills are also quadruple distilling the vodka. But the process doesn't end there. The spirit is then triple filtered.
We use a charcoal filtration to begin with, and then a rough cellulose filter and a fine cellulose filter to remove particulate matter. The result of that is a crisp, clean, odor-free vodka.
Using computer-controlled technology, Sky distills more than 2 million cases of premium vodka every year. Here and at other modern distilleries, the process may bear little resemblance to the pot stills of the American frontier, but the echoes of tradition are undeniable.
The stuff that actually comes in contact with the liquids is 19th century technology, and everything else is 21st century. They're whittling down to the bare minimum that has to be traditional to guarantee the quality of the spirit.
Whether it's vodka, gin, whiskey, rum, or tequila, technology will continue to influence the process of distilling, making it faster, more economical, and more consistent from bottle to bottle. But the consumer is the ultimate judge of quality. And despite new formulas and endless marketing, the great distilleries will always look to the past to define the future of excellence in the world of